This podcast is made possible by you, the supporters of WPLN and WNXP, Nashville Public Radio.
This is the Nash Villager Podcast. It's November 6th, 2024, the day after the election. I'm Nina Cardona, and this is your daily digest of what's happening around Middle Tennessee from Nashville Public Radio, WPLN News. We'll dig into the election results in the newscast portion of this podcast, but for the moment, here are the quick takeaways. Donald Trump won Tennessee in the presidential election. Nashville's transit referendum passed. Senator Marsha Blackburn held off the Democratic challenge from Gloria Johnson, as did the three Republican congressmen who represent Nashville. And Democrats won to closely watched contests for state legislative seats. Again, we'll dig in more deeply into those results in the newscast. We're now in that span of days where American history is full of momentous dates related to election results. And as our nation figures out what all was decided on yesterday's ballot, I thought this would be a good time to look at how things went in one of this nation's most momentous and tumultuous elections ever. In 1860, Election Day fell on November 6th, but it took months to determine a winner. For one thing, it wasn't a clean two-candidate race. Abraham Lincoln was the presidential nominee for the relatively new Republican Party, but the Democratic Party split into two factions, with both Stephen Douglas and John Breckinridge running for president. And a third party called the Constitutional Union was also trying to make a go of it with a guy named John Bell. And when it came down to counting ballots, that large number of candidates did split the field to some degree. In terms of the popular vote, Lincoln took more than any other candidate, but he came short of a majority endorsement, with 40% of Americans picking him. His win was more straightforward in the Electoral College. Given the way electoral votes were allocated between the states, Lincoln secured 180 compared to the 130 held by all of the other candidates combined. But of course, in 1860, it wasn't just about numbers. Several southern states had made it clear they would not accept a Lincoln presidency. But there's still a question of how much of that was political grandstanding and what kind of real actions those states would be willing to take. So in that moment, at the start of November, there was a real question of whether they would attempt to throw a wrench into the works by boycotting the Electoral College. In the weeks after the election, constitutional scholars tried to figure out what would legally constitute a quorum if some electors just didn't show up, or if they even could hold a vote without everyone. There was also some talk of electors making a shift. Now, there's been a lot of legal discussion through the years of how much leeway electors have to chart a new course that veers away from the popular vote. These days, some states specifically require their electors to reflect the people's choice. But even now, the Supreme Court recognizes that the U.S. Constitution gives electors the leeway to make a different choice. And back in 1860, people were way more open to that idea. So, after the November election, some Democratic electors considered consolidating behind a single candidate instead of continuing to split between their two guys. Both Republicans and Democrats were trying to get Constitutional Union electors to throw in with them. And with all of the political disarray, even some of the electors from Lincoln's own party considered jumping ship and voting for someone else in hopes of preserving the union. Ultimately, the Southern focus shifted. They went ahead and participated in the electoral vote. They let it be certified in February. And then they seceded, sparking this nation's civil war. This time around, states have until December 11th to certify their electors. The Electoral College is scheduled to gather this December 17th. Congress is due to count and certify those votes on January 6th. And the presidential inauguration is set for January 20th. In just a few minutes, a post-election change of pace on this week's edition of What Wear Wednesday. That's coming up after the newscast.
Nashville Public Radio is always here to keep you informed, whether it's the latest news or music you should check out. Every week, What Wear Wednesday shares the latest happenings taking place right here in Nashville by talking to members of our community, putting on events in your neighborhood and beyond. So tune in to What Wear Wednesdays every Wednesday, and you can always find events at wnxp.org/events.
Here's the latest from WPLN News. Within just 2 minutes of polls closing, Tennessee's 11 electoral votes were called for former President Donald Trump last night. The state has been reliably red since 2000. Maggie Wegner lives in Williamson County. She used to consider herself a liberal, but now she supports Trump.
I voted for Donald Trump and J.D. Vance. I care about the border. I care about gender ideology getting taken out of schools. I care about having lower prices at the grocery store. And just overall, I think my life was better when Donald Trump was president compared to when Biden and Harris had been in office. So those are all really big reasons for me.
U.S. Senator Marsha Blackburn is heading back to Washington, having won her re-election campaign. WPLN's Mariana Bacayao was at Blackburn's election night watch party and has this report.
Blackburn addressed a crowded room of supporters, including Governor Bill Lee and State Attorney General Jonathan Skrmetti. Soon after polls closed, the AP called the race in her favor, and her opponent, State Representative Gloria Johnson, called to concede.
So I thank Gloria for the call, and I do look forward to working with her on behalf of all Tennesseans.
Blackburn's decisive victory comes a few months after Donald Trump considered her for his vice presidential pick. In her victory speech, Blackburn touched on border security with the slogan, "Build the Wall," and her opposition to transgender rights.
And that we protect our children and make certain that when it comes to protecting our girls in sports, that we know what a woman is and what a woman.
Democratic candidate Johnson, on the other hand, will continue to serve in the Tennessee State House. Mariana Bacayao, WPLN News.
Republican incumbents have been reelected in Middle Tennessee's three U.S. congressional districts. In District 5, Andy Ogles beat gun reform advocate Miriam Ebel-Fosley. Ogles faces an ongoing FBI investigation into his campaign finances. He's still projected to win by a wide margin. District 6 incumbent John Rose fended off a challenge from disability rights advocate Lori Bergman. Bergman focused on abortion rights in her campaign. Rose campaigned on repealing Obamacare. And Mark Green won a lopsided victory against former Nashville Mayor Megan Berry in District 7. Nashville's transportation landscape is about to change. Davidson County has become the first county in the state to establish dedicated transit funding via referendum. WPLN Cynthia Abrams reports that city leaders feel it's a long time coming.
Nashvillians have spoken. Two-thirds of voters cast ballots for better transit. That will mean a half-cent sales tax increase starting in February. It also means major transportation upgrades, albeit in the long term. Over the coming decades, there will be 86 miles of new sidewalks, a dozen new transit centers, and a bus rapid transit network.
For the next generation, we will all enjoy the things we deserve: sidewalks, signals, service, and safety.
Mayor Freddie O'Connell made it clear in a victory speech that Nashville's lack of robust transportation and the city's previous failure to approve dedicated funding had cast a shadow. He thanked former Mayor Megan Berry for getting the ball rolling 6 years ago and commended his transportation advisor, Michael Briggs, for his resilience.
It's an open bar, and if you give Michael enough drinks, he'll lift up his shirt and show you the scars from 2018. But he said, "I'm back, and I'm going to do it this time."
But where the 2018 referendum failed resoundingly, this year's success was just as decisive, meaning Nashville will have transit funding for generations to come. Cynthia Abrams, WPLN News.
All of Tennessee's state House seats were up for election yesterday, but only a few led to competitive contests. In Nashville, incumbent Democrat Bo Mitchell won with 54% in his Bellevue area district. After running unopposed in prior contests, he defeated a challenger who serves on the Metro Council. Across the county in Old Hickory, a political newcomer won the open seat vacated by a longtime representative. Shondell Brooks has been a fierce advocate for gun reform since her son was killed in the 2018 Waffle House shooting.
Nashville State House incumbents Heidi Campbell, Afton Bain, Justin Jones, and Jason Powell easily won their reelection campaigns. Republican incumbents also held off Democratic newcomers in Rutherford County, where Mike Sparks held his seat, and in Clarksville, where Jeff Burkhart won. A Tennessee man with links to a white nationalist group has been arrested for trying to destroy an energy plant. Skylar Phillippe intended to blow up a Nashville electric substation by attaching several pounds of plastic explosives to a drone. The plan was to have the drone enter the facility. His plan was discovered when he confided in an undercover law official. Phillippe says he belonged to a few white nationalist and extremist groups who want to attack the nation's power grids. Nashville health officials say the number of deaths related to drug overdose is on a continued decline. In the first 9 months of the year, the Nashville Banner reports the total number of deaths came in 26% lower than in the same time last year, and emergency room visits from suspected overdoses are down too. That improvement reflects a national trend, and it follows a concerted effort to increase access to the overdose reversal drug naloxone. Still, Nashville's overdose death rate is about five times as high as the number of deaths by homicide, and authorities note a dramatic rise in the number of cases involving a livestock tranquilizer called xylazine. You'll find more news anytime at WPLN.org. As important as it is to fully engage with all of the election results and what they mean for the future, politics can be stressful. You gotta engage in some self-care, too. Like taking in some good entertainment.
I'm Marquise Munson, here with another edition of Nashville Public Radio's What Wear Wednesday, keeping you up to date with the happenings in Nashville this week. From Billie Eilish at Bridgestone Arena, White Animals at Exit Inn, Leon Bridges' three-night residency at the Ryman, Jelani Arie at Row 1 Stage at Cannery Hall, and WNXP presents Orion Sun at the Basement East. For more events, head over to WNXP.org/events. Close to the sun. You're trying to get me back, but I'm gone, gone, gone. These days, I'm trying to keep my head above water. After a very grueling election week, I think we can all use a laugh. This week for What Were Wednesdays, we discuss the 8th annual Third Coast Improv Fest happening this weekend.
My name is Emma Supika. I'm the founding director of Unscripted.
I'm Luke Watson. I'm one of the co-founders of Third Coast Comedy Club and founder of the Third Coast Improv Fest. Me and my business partner who opened the theater with me, Scott Field, we both were doing improv separately in town. So I had LOL Nashville, which did improv comedy, both short and long form, which was kind of new to Nashville to have a group doing both. And Scott Field was with Music City Improv, which was mainly doing short and mid-form improv. So we started teaching classes together, which was great. We had a good relationship and a good chemistry. They were losing their spot at the building in East Nashville, which was kind of behind, next to Beyond the Edge. And but they were losing their building. And we were every month finding a new place. And we were awesome venues, iconic venues in Nashville. But it was just a grind to find a new one each month. The Basement gave us our first shot. And we ended up doing like Basement East, City Winery, 12th and Porter when it was around. But there was no brick and mortar for improv comedy in Nashville. And so after class one night, I just literally threw out the idea of like, hey, I want to open a theater. And he's like, I've been thinking about that too. We should grab a beer. We did. And the rest is history. So that's how Third Coast came to be. It took us a year to find a spot in Marathon Village, and we opened in 2016 and, knock on wood, made it through COVID and are still here.
Unscripted was founded in 2017. So a year after Third Coast opened, you know, Luke and Scott were like, we want to have some community element to this theater. And I was getting my master's degree in nonprofit leadership at Belmont and wanted to start an arts nonprofit and had been taking improv classes. I wrote my master's thesis on applied improv. I didn't really know that term at the time, actually, but it was just like people who were using improv to better people. And so I wrote a bunch of case studies on that, and that helped inform kind of the direction of Unscripted. It was sort of this, like, we know that this has value for the community. And then I was like, all right, let me figure out how we can implement this. And then we just started saying yes to programs. I think improv helps everywhere. I joke around about how, like, I have yet to discover the space where improv is not help.
A lot of the classes in those formative years, there weren't a lot of improv groups in town. And so people would get addicted to improv, fall in love with improv, and there wasn't like a lot of opportunities out there. Because some groups, there were only like really a few in town, one of which didn't hold auditions ever, and two held annual auditions. So like, if you wanted to get plugged in, there was not really opportunity. So people were starting groups, which was great. And they were doing a lot of indie groups performing in like bars and music venues around town. So we wanted a place while this was all being created to have a place where the locals could have a night together. And then very quickly that turned into the idea of, well, why don't we just open it up to like Atlanta and, you know, regional. And then just like within a couple of weeks, the idea to speak grew to like, let's just do a national festival in Nashville.
This year's festival, we had record number submissions. You know, the festival has been really successful in previous years, and Unscripted has been the beneficiary of like the proceeds. This year, we're playing a little bit more of a role in the production of the festival. And I'm so excited for just the shows. Like every single night, every single block, there are incredible performers, not just the visiting teams. Like we've got two incredible headliners, Ruby Rocket, who does this like film noir. Luke and I got to see her perform last October. So, so fun. She brings on like surprise guests. And then Three-Peat is on Saturday night. They've been with Comedy Central. Like we've got some big names coming in, but also like the local talent, the local teams have exploded in the last year or so, like just the independent teams. So outstanding stuff there. And then we've got incredible teams from New York, Chicago, Atlanta, like all over the place who are coming here for this one weekend. So if anybody has been curious about improv or like, hey, I think I like improv, like this is the weekend to come see it because you're going to see people you could see again here in Nashville, and you're going to be able to see teams, troops, styles, play style, all of this that you don't typically have. You'd have to travel to New York. You'd have to travel to Chicago to go see them.
For more information on Third Coast Improv Fest and other events happening this week, visit WNXP.org. My name is Marquise Munson, and thank you for listening to another edition of What Were Wednesdays.
I used to walk on the darker side, rain in my eyes, rain in my eyes.
We do this roundup of Nashville news every weekday, so subscribe in your favorite podcasting app to make sure you never miss an episode. And if you like this, you'll probably enjoy the Nash Villager newsletter, too. You'll get perspective from more of my colleagues at Nashville Public Radio and links to the stories we're following. Sign up for those daily emails at WPLN.org/Nash Villager. While you're there, you can also donate to the station. Thanks so much for listening. Let's make this day a good one, and we'll catch back up tomorrow. Thank you.